Matthew chapter 28, Matthew's resurrection chapter, Matthew chapter 28. The last few weeks we've been looking at events surrounding, involved in Holy Week, the week from Palm Sunday to this morning. Next Sunday I want to continue that kind of loose series of different events and go back to Holy Week one more time. We're going to do it in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. This is for next Sunday if you want to read it and think about it this week. I hope you'll be back. I believe God's going to share a profound truth with us. Frankly, for many years, I stayed away from preaching from that passage because I was afraid I didn't really understand it. And several years ago, I heard somebody preach from it, and something, a light went off in my spirit, and it's incredible. And so I hope you'll be back next Sunday for a powerful, powerful service, and I believe a significant message from God's Word. Thank you for all of you who are here Good Friday. We had a great crowd, and it was fun. We had a good service and powerful, so I'm grateful for all of you that came for our maiden voyage for a Good Friday service here at Wapakoneta Community Worship Center. Matthew chapter 28. We'll read the whole chapter this morning. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who is crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, where they will see me." While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, 'His disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep.' If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." That's a mild statement. If they would have lost a prisoner like that, they would have been killed. So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed, and this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." And may the Lord add his blessing to his word today. And let me as well say happy Easter, happy Resurrection Day. I don't think I've said that yet. What a great day. Once there was a spider who lived in a tree. The webs he wove were the strongest, the glossiest, the stickiest webs that a spider could ever construct. Many bugs and beetles, many ants and other insects found themselves caught, quick-dried, and stored away in his loaded larder. One thing alone troubled his tranquil existence. Close to his tree ran a railroad track, and each morning when the train whooshed by, his house shuddered and shook. Sometimes he even lost a few of the tasty tidbits he had intended to eat for a treat. "That's the last straw," he screamed one day when he found part of his house torn away. "I'll put a stop to that train. It won't trouble me anymore." That night he spun a long, glossy filament that rolled out and out and out. When the wind gave a stronger puff than usual, he leaped high into the air and went flying across the track to the tree that grew on the other side. Now his evil plan began. back and forth, back and forth. From tree to tree he ran, weaving the strongest, the stickiest, the glossiest web any spider could ever construct. None had ever been so fine, so strong, so tough, so utterly unbreakable. "I'll seal it with a seal," he muttered as he glued it doubly fast. "I'll get some of my friends to guard it as well. They'll make it as sure as they can." The next morning, the whoo of the train could be heard. It was the express, and it was coming awfully fast. "Ha ha!" laughed the spider. "What a wreck this is going to be!" "Hoo-hoo!" called the train. "Ha ha!" laughed the spider. "Hoo! Whoosh!" Remember when Pilate said to the chief priests, who were afraid someone might try to steal the body of Jesus, he said, "Take a guard and put a seal on it and make it as sure as you can." Hallelujah. Little did he know a train was coming. Let's reset the scene. At dawn, the two Marys are on their way to the tomb. There's a violent earthquake. The stone is rolled away by an angel. The guards are so petrified, they nearly die of heart failure. The angel assures the women Jesus is alive and they'll find him in Galilee. You wonder what profound statement, what amazing explanation will the resurrected Jesus give to mark this moment? He says, "Greetings." The common informal way somebody in that day would say, "Hey, how are you doing? Nice day, isn't it? What's up?" If you're from Philly, "How you doing?" He says, "Greetings." Greetings. Dale Bruner, wonderful commentary, translates it like this. And look, Jesus met them and said, "Hi." In other words, what did you expect? Didn't I tell you? A pastor tried to tell this story in a children's sermon. He asked, what were Jesus' first words to the disciples after he was raised from the dead? Before he could give Matthew's answer, a little girl waved her hand and the pastor deferred to her. I know," she said. "Ta-da!" It's as good a translation as any. I like it better than the one there, "Greetings." That Sunday changed everything. I'm glad Easter's in the spring, even though somebody spoke some curse words a moment ago about something else, maybe falling. Spring has sprung, the grass has risen. I wonder where the flowers is. Flowers are blooming by faith. Life is eternal. Everything is going to work out. God has an answer to death. His answer's life. Eternal, abundant, wonderful, glorious, fabulous life. There's a story told in Brazil about a missionary who discovered a tribe of Indians in a remote part of the jungle. They lived near a large river. The tribe was friendly and in need of medical attention. A contagious disease was ravaging the population and people were dying daily. An infirmary was located in another part of the jungle, and the missionary determined that the only hope for the tribe was to go to the hospital for inoculations. In order to reach the hospital, however, the Indians would have to cross the river, a feat they were unwilling to perform. The river, they believed, was inhabited by evil spirits. To enter the water meant certain death. The missionary went about the difficult task of overcoming the superstition of the tribe. He explained how he had crossed the river and arrived unharmed in coming to them. No luck. He led the people to the bank and placed his hand in the water. The people still wouldn't believe him. He walked out into the river and splashed water over his head and face. The people watched closely but were still hesitant. Finally, he turned and dove into the water. He swam beneath the surface until he emerged on the other side. Having proved the power of the river was a farce, the missionary punched a triumphant fist into the air. He had entered the water and escaped unharmed. The Indians broke into cheers and followed him across. Jesus saw people enslaved by their fear of a cheap power. He explained that the river of death was nothing to fear. The people wouldn't believe him. He touched a boy and called him back to life. The followers were still unconvinced. He whispered life into the dead body of a little girl. The people were still cynical. He let a dead man spend 4 days and 4 nights in a grave and then called him out alive. Is that enough? Apparently not. For it was necessary for him, our Lord, to enter the river, to submerge himself in the water of death before people would believe that death had been conquered. Hebrews says it, by his death, he destroyed him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and freed those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. Jesus has utterly destroyed Satan's power. Satan is a nothing. He's a zero, a zilch. Death has no power. It has no terror for the blood-bought ones. Oh, glory, hallelujah to the Lamb. I like the epitaph on the grave of a man named Pease. It goes something like this. Here lies Pease beneath the trees, under the sod. But peace is not here, only the pod. For peace shelled out and went home to God. Hallelujah. Preacher was doing a graveside service for one of his departed church members. Growing in the cemetery was a walnut tree, and there were some walnuts on the ground, and the preacher, you know, kind of got an idea. It's a little dangerous when we get ideas and stray from our notes. And he began comparing the dearly departed, you know, to the walnuts on the ground. And he says, thank God, folks, this body is just a shell. The nut is gone. Hallelujah. Death has no power. It has no terror for the blood-bought ones. Oh, glory. Hallelujah to the Lamb. How does the resurrection apply to us? What does it mean to us today? Matthew uses an interesting literary method. When he's describing the events of Holy Week, he embeds in the description of the events of this week Jesus' own statement. He gives our Lord's own perspective of what is taking place. In other words, Jesus is giving the commentary. He's saying, now this is exactly what this means. For a long time, when I read Matthew 28, I thought Matthew 28 was divided into two parts, the discussion of the resurrection, the events, and then the Great Commission on the mountain. And I didn't realize until not too long ago that it's really all part of one story, one narrative here. When Jesus is giving the Great Commission, he is explaining the meaning of the resurrection to us. He is telling us where he is today. If he's alive, what does it mean to us? Where will we find him? We find him by the right hand of the throne of the universe. He's in the ministry of the gospel. He is with us in the church, and he is at the end of the world. First, Jesus is by the right hand of God. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Ephesians adds, he is seated at the Father's right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. All authority is given to me. He's at the right hand of the throne of God. Thrones are out of our bailiwick. We have governors, presidents, legislatures. We're not really accustomed to thinking of thrones, but at the right hand of the throne sits the prime minister, where royal power is executed and divine favor is granted. Can you imagine how comforting this is? Our lives matter. We have purpose. We are called men and women of destiny and prophecy. Whatever happens to us, Romans 8:28 says, good or bad, whether God planned it or not, God has pledged to work all things together for our good and his plan. In his book, A Casket of Cameos, F.W. Borum reflects on the faith of Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom. The old slave had been wrenched from his old Kentucky home and put on a steamship headed for unknown places. It was a terrible moment of crisis, and Borum observes, quote, Uncle Tom's faith was staggered. It really seemed to him that in leaving Aunt Chloe and the children and his old companions, he was leaving God. Falling asleep, the slave had a dream. He dreamed that he was back again and that little Eva was reading to him from the Bible as of old. He could hear her voice. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. Borum continues, a little later, poor Tom was writhing under the cruel lash of his new owner. But, says Mrs. Stowe, the blows fell upon the outer man and not, as before, on the heart. Tom stood still submissive, and yet Legree could not hide from himself the fact that his power over his victim had gone. As Tom disappeared in his cabin and Legree wheeled his horse suddenly round, there passed through the tyrant's mind one of those vivid flashes that often send the lightning of conscience across the dark and wicked soul. He understood full well that it was God who was standing between him and Tom, and he blasphemed him. Reminds me of the first martyr, Stephen. His name means crown. He was full of faith, the Holy Spirit and power. He was used to perform wonders and miracles. He was arrested on trumped-up charges, just like our Lord. At his trial, we read in Acts, all who were sitting in the Sanhedrin looked intently at Stephen, and they saw that his face was like the face of an angel. Richard Baxter famously said, I preach as a dying man to dying men. That was Stephen's demeanor. With a laser thrust of truth, the Holy Spirit guides him to preach. He exposes their hypocrisy and they go berserk. Dragging him out of the city, they stone him. With his dying breath, he prays for his killers. Where does he get his poise? Acts 7:55 gives the answer, but Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing where? At the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Why was Stephen calm? He saw Jesus at the right hand of God. History wasn't out of control. He knew somehow his death would work out for good and the glory of his resurrected Lord who was calling the shots. Acts 8:1 gives the historical perspective. It marks a major turning point in the book of Acts and in the history of the church and the world. It says, and Saul was there giving approval to his death. He wasn't just condoning it. He arranged it. But something in that moment spoke to Saul. The Holy Spirit was preparing him to hear Jesus ask him on the road to Damascus, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Without Stephen, there might not be an Apostle Paul. There might not have been a break with Judaism, nor worldwide Christianity. It is the persecution following Stephen's death that propels the church into all the world with the gospel. Jesus says, all authority is mine. I'm your representative. your Lord, your brother, your friend, your king. Whatever's happening to you will make sense someday. God will make everything work out for our good and his glory. Second, Jesus is in the ministry of the gospel. He says in verse 19, go and therefore, because I'm at the right hand of God and all authority is mine, therefore you go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. What Jesus brought to a few, healing, grace, the good news of God's love, the church, you and I can now bring to all. What a glorious privilege. It's a serious thing, wrote C.S. Lewis, to live in a society of possible gods and goddesses, to remember that the dullest and most uninteresting person you talk to may one day be a creature which, if you saw it now, you would be strongly tempted to worship, or else a horror and a corruption such as you now meet, if at all, only in a nightmare. Listen to this now. All day long, we are, in some degree or another, helping each of these to one or another of these destinations. Think of that. We are helping them to one or the other of those destinations. Ancient religions such as the Roman paganism of Jesus' day believed that the actions of the gods in the heavens above affected the earth below. If Zeus got angry, thunderbolts shot out, like kids dropping rocks off of highway bridges onto cars below. The gods rained cataclysm onto the earth. As above, so below went the ancient formula. Jesus, though, inverted that plan. As below, so above, he taught. He who listens to you listens to me, Jesus told his followers. He who rejects you rejects me. A believer prays and heaven responds. A sinner repents and angels rejoice. A mission succeeds and Satan falls like lightning. A believer rebels and the Holy Spirit is grieved. What we humans do affects the cosmos. I believe these things, and yet somehow I keep forgetting them. I forget that my prayers matter to God. I forget that I am helping my neighbors to their eternal destinations. I forget that the choices I make today bring delight or grief to the Lord of the universe. When Jesus departed, he left the keys of the kingdom in our hands. We bring light out of darkness. In the name of Jesus, St. Francis kissed the beggar and took off his robes. Mother Teresa founded the home for the dying. Wilberforce freed the slaves. General Booth established an urban army of salvation, and Dorothy Day fed the hungry. It's through the church that Jesus' prophecy of Isaiah 61 and Luke 4:16 is happening. It's through you and me that he is preaching the gospel to the poor. He is healing the brokenhearted and preaching deliverance to the captives and the recovery of sight to the blind. Through us, he is setting at liberty the bruised and declaring the year of the Lord's favor, the year of Jubilee. We declare God is for us. He's for us. That's our message to Wapak. In our county, in our world, God is for us. One of my core values as a pastor has been and is Ephesians 4:11 and following, where Jesus is raised victorious from the grave, and he comes into the church in a triumphal entry, much like a ticker tape parade in Rome, and he gives gifts to the church, and among those gifts are leaders, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, and others. What's significant to me about that passage is the job description of leaders, and that is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. God has called you to ministry in the church and outside the church. And one of my constant goals wherever I serve is to connect people to ministry teams. And if you're not involved in an ongoing ministry, I urge you, I implore you, please become involved in a ministry team, because it's through your ministry. That's where you find Jesus. It's in the ministry. You saw these fantastic students, young students up here. We need more workers there in that department, shaping and forming lives. I'm grateful that my kids grew up in spectacular churches that invested in their generation, and they discovered that the sharpest people in all the world were God's people. And I urge you, we have areas of our building that need some maintenance and fixer-uppers, and some of you are really gifted in that area. But there's a place in the back, a sheet to sign up and say, I want to join a ministry team, and maybe indicate where you'd like to be involved. God has gifted us, and he's put passions in us to glorify him. And if we don't find our place where our giftings and our passions intersect in a ministry area, we're frustrated. We want to honor God with our lives. We want to do more than come and sit and sing and pray and leave and pay our tithes. We need to be involved ourselves. Michelangelo, Bach, Rembrandt, the masons of the cathedrals and many like them offered up the best of their creation for the glory of God alone. You and I, we are God's hands on the earth. We will open them wide to the world God has called us to for his glory. There should be no unemployed Christians. And again, one of my deep-seated longings is for every believer to discover their gifts and their passions and to use them in a place of involvement in extending the ministry of God's kingdom. Paul wrote to the Ephesians, he said, Jesus came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. How could he say that? Jesus never physically visited Ephesus, but Paul did. And when Paul preached, Jesus was preaching to them. He said, Christ came to you. When you care for a child in the nursery, when you make a guest feel welcome in the house of God, when you help a youngster build a Pinewood Derby car or minister to a family in one of our outreaches or pray for people at the altar, whatever you do in ministry for the glory of God, Jesus himself works with you. It's the good news. People know they're lost. They know they're sinners. They know they haven't measured up. They know that. We don't have to tell them. We don't have to criticize them. I don't know of anybody that was criticized into the kingdom of God. They know they're sinners. They know God has something better for them. They're just waiting for Jesus to come to them through you and through me. You know, children are aware. Sophia Cavalletti is a researcher who pioneered the study of spirituality in children. She finds that children often have an amazing perception that far surpasses what they have been taught. One three-year-old girl raised in an atheistic family with no church contact, no Bible in the home, no connection with believers. She asked her father one day, where did the world come from? He answered her in strictly naturalistic scientific terms. Then he added, there are some people who say all of this comes from a very powerful being and they call him God. At this, the little girl started dancing around the room with joy. I knew what you were telling me wasn't true, she said. It's him, it's him. Writer Anne Lamott was raised by her dad to be a devout atheist. She and her siblings all had to agree to a contract to that effect when they were 2 or 3 years old. Imagine making your children agree to a contract that there is no God when you're just a little child. But Anne said she started backsliding into faith. I love that phrase. She started backsliding into faith at an early age. She said, even when I was a little child, I knew that when I said hello, someone heard. Someone hears. God, do you want to find the resurrected Lord? Join a ministry team. See, Marcia Comer, there's somewhere out there a sign-up sheet where you can indicate, and we'll be in touch with you and train you and connect you, but please join a ministry team. Third, Jesus is with us in community. The last verse says, "And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." The word "surely" is often translated "behold," or "look," or "surprise." Something spectacular is coming. What's the shocking surprise? I'm with you always. Really? That's a surprise? Okay, great. Jesus is with me wherever I go. You know, even if I stray into Ann Arbor, you know, he's there with me. But that isn't the point. We don't catch it because we're from the north. The word "you" is plural. Unless we hail from Alabama and we understand "y'all," we miss it. He's saying, because I'm the risen Lord, you all will find me in community. I am with you all, with you in community. God has designed us to hunger for community. It's why Plato wrote the Republic and Augustine, the City of God. It's why so many stories are about longing for community, from the Odyssey to Walton's Mountain, from Camelot to Lake Wobegon, from Mayberry to Boys in the Hood. It's why we join churches and bowling leagues and go on blind dates. It's why the single most remembered American speech in the 20th century was a plea for all human beings one day being able to eat together at the table of fellowship, join hands, and sing a common song. It wasn't just Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream that captured the conscience of a society. He was articulating God's dream. Mother Teresa said that loneliness is the leprosy of modern society, and no one wants anybody to know they're a leper. We were made to know oneness. There's a little refrain that reoccurs again and again in the creation song. And God said, and it was so, and God saw that it was good. God said, let there be light. Oh, there's light. And God said, hey, that's good. Did you see it? Did you see that? Pretty good. And the next day he does things and, hey, did you see that? He said it. It happened. That was good. Did you see that was really good? That's the refrain until the final act when God makes man. And then there's a jarring, jangling, screeching halt. And God says, it's not good. And we say, huh? What do you mean it's not good? And God says, it's not good for man to be alone. It's not good for man to be alone. This is a radical comment about the fundamental importance of human relationships. What is striking is that the fall has not yet occurred. There's no sin, no disobedience, nothing to mar the relationship between God and man. The human being is in a state of perfect intimacy with God. Each word he and God speak with each other is filled with closeness and joy. He walks with God in the garden in the cool of the day. He is known and loved to the core of his being by this omniscient, love-filled creator. Yet the word God uses to describe him is alone, and God said that this aloneness is not good. Sometimes in church circles, when people feel lonely, we tell them not to expect too much from human relationships, that there's inside every human a God-shaped vacuum that no other person can fill. And that is true, by the way. God's put a measure of eternity in everybody's heart. Everybody knows there's something else there that only God can fill. But apparently, according to the writer of Genesis, Moses, according to Moses, God creates inside this man a kind of human-shaped void that God himself will not fill. No substitute will fill this need in you for human relationships. Not money, not achievement, not busyness, not books, not entertainment, not even God himself. Even though this man was in a state of sinless perfection, he was alone, and it was not good. Community is God's desire for your life. It is the one indispensable condition for human flourishing. According to Jean Vanier, quote, a community is not simply a group of people who live together and love each other. It is a place of resurrection. To see why community means so much to God, we have to go all the way back in time and try to think about what life was like before anything else ever existed. And this is where the doctrine of the Trinity becomes so critically important. You know, growing up, I remember confusing metaphors, trying to help me understand the Trinity, as if anything could. Comparing the Godhead to an egg, you know, that has the shell, the white and the yolk, or like water that's a liquid or a solid, hopefully not today, or what steam, the other one is steam. But I confess to you that they weren't very helpful to me. The early church didn't describe the Trinity like that. The earliest attempts to teach what the Trinity meant talks about persons, three persons, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, that are in such perfect intimate unity and fellowship and connection that they are one God, yet three distinct persons. Did you ever wonder what life was like inside the Godhead? We'll explore this further next week, but do you think they bickered about who is the most omniscient or who is the most omnipotent? You know, do you think it's like a marriage where the couple argues about who's going to take out the trash and who's going to do the dishes? Probably not. The life of God is a life of self-giving and other-receiving love, writes Miroslav Volf. Father, Son, and Spirit are so close that Jesus could say, the Father is in me and I am in the Father. The ancient Greeks had a word for this. Again, we'll explore it more next week, but the word for this indwelling, mutual indwelling of the Trinity, the word is perichoresis, and it means to dance or flow around. It's where we get our word, our idea of choreography. The Trinity exists in an eternal dance of joyful love among Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They constantly revolve around the other to bless them. Frederick Bruner characterizes life within the Trinity in terms of shyness. He says the Holy Spirit always points to Jesus and glorifies him. When he teaches, Bruner sometimes represents the ministry of the Spirit by drawing a stick figure on a chalkboard to represent Jesus. Then to express what the Spirit does, he hides behind the chalkboard, reaches finger around, and points to the stick figure and says, look at him! Listen to him! Learn from him! Follow him! Worship him! Be devoted to him! Serve him! Love him! Be preoccupied with him! When you look at the Son, oddly enough, we don't see him walking around saying, I'm the greatest! No, he says, if I glorify myself, my glory means nothing. He came to seek and to save the lost. He came to be served, not to be served, but to serve. He submitted to the Spirit who, according to Mark, drove him into the wilderness. He came to do the Father's will. The Father's also shy. Two times we hear his voice in the New Testament, and each time the message is the same. Hey, this is my Son. This is my Son. I'm proud of my Son. Follow my Son. Serve my Son. Love my Son. I'm pleased with my Son. The community of the Trinity is marked by shyness, not timidity, but humble servanthood, mutual submission, love, and delight that for us is unimaginable. In Jesus' death and resurrection, he made it possible for you and me to join the divine community. Jesus prays in his high priestly prayer in John 17, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for all of those who will believe in me through their message, that all may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. That's why Jesus says, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. When we relate to one another with the same spirit of servanthood, submission, and delight that characterizes Jesus in the Trinity, whenever that happens, Jesus says, I can't stand idly by. I have to be part of it. I have to be basking in it, cheering it on, loving it, enjoying it, infiltrating it. Wherever two or three are gathered in my name in symphony, loving one, I've got to be in the middle of that. A community of loving people is God's signature. I need the church. People say, I can be a Christian without the church. Hogwash. That's it's not in my notes. That's a technical theological term. No way. I can't grasp the richness of Jesus by myself. You know, I've been privileged to encounter Jesus in a variety of cultural settings. I wish this morning I could transport all of us to Ethiopia. I wish we could experience the excitement, the exuberance of our brothers and sisters, the power in their singing, dancing. We talk about, you know, dance is Jesus. You go to Ethiopia to see people dance. They're dancing, their worship, it's unequaled. They do this thing where they get down and I don't know what in the world they're doing, but I do it too because it's just so much fun. But they do this and it's spectacular. I wish you could go with me. Wish you could feel it. I wish you could go with me to a Friday night prayer meeting on Prayer Mountain just outside of Seoul, Korea, where there's 1,000 or more people on their faces crying out to God in the deepest intercessions I've ever felt. I just stepped into the room and the power of God just almost knocks you down. And they're crying and they're weeping and they're saying, God, we need you, we need you. I wish you could go with me to Argentina to watch teenagers and children going out on the streets and being used to perform miracles, praying for the sick and seeing them healed, being used in words of wisdom and words of knowledge and discerning of spirits. Children, there's so much we can learn from one another. Look, surprise, Jesus says. I'm with you when you plug into the church. And finally, Jesus is at the end of the world. When history is over, Jesus announces, I'll be there. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He's the world's happy ending. History is his story. He will wipe away every tear. He'll make everything right. There's a place in Tolkien's epic novel, The Lord of the Rings, where Sam wakes up and says, Gandalf, I thought you were dead. But then I thought I was dead myself. Is everything sad going to come untrue? Jesus has an answer to Sam's plaintive question. Yes, Sam, everything sad is going to come untrue. The fairy tales are all true. There is a knight who will slay all dragons. There's a superhero who will save the world. The crosses will be swallowed up in resurrection. I stand at the end of the age, Jesus promises. I am the world's happy ending. Tony Campolo delivers a stirring message adapted from an elderly black pastor in Philadelphia. It's Friday, but Sunday's a coming. Maybe you've seen it sometime. In a cadence that increases in tempo and in volume, Campolo contrasts how the world looked on Friday when the forces of evil won over the forces of good, when every friend and disciple fled in fear, when the Son of God died on the cross, with how it looked on Easter Sunday. The disciples who lived through both days, Friday and Sunday, never doubted God again. They learned when God seems most absent, he may be the closest of all. When God looks most powerless, he may be the most powerful. When God looks most dead, he may be coming back to life. They learned never to count God out. Campolo skipped a day in his sermon. The other 2 days have names: Good Friday, Easter Sunday. You and I live on Saturday, the day with no name. What the disciples experienced in a small scale, 3 days, in grief over one man who had died on a cross, we now live on a cosmic scale. Human history grinds on between the time of promise and fulfillment. Can we trust that God can make something holy and beautiful and good out of a world that includes Syria and Parkland and inner city ghettos and jammed prisons in the richest nation on earth? It's Saturday on planet Earth. Will Sunday ever come? The dark Golgothan Friday can only be called good because of what happened on Easter Sunday, a day which gives a tantalizing clue to the riddle of the universe. Easter opened a crack in the universe, winding down toward entropy and decay, sealing the promise that someday God will enlarge the miracle of Easter to cosmic scale. It's a good thing to remember that in this cosmic drama, we live out our days on Saturday, the in-between day with no name. I read of a woman whose grandmother lies buried under an 150-year-old live oak tree in the cemetery of an Episcopal church in rural Louisiana. In accordance with the grandmother's instructions, only one word is carved on her tombstone: waiting. Waiting. The German theologian Jürgen Moltmann expresses in a single sentence the great span from Good Friday to Easter. It is, in fact, a summary of human history, past, present, and future. God weeps with us so that we may someday laugh with him. Or in the words of Revelation 21:4, he will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. And when we get there, we will say, I've come home at last. This is my real country. I belong here. This is the land I've been looking for all my life, though I never knew it. And it will be by no means the end of the story. In fact, as C.S. Lewis put it, quote, all adventures we have ever had will end up being only the cover and title page. Finally, we will begin chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before. I can hardly wait. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, as we move toward the close of this Resurrection Day service, may you draw us to Jesus, I pray, in Christ's name. Listen as Larry Good ministers, What Will You Do? Thank you.
laugh at me and turn me away. Say anything that you want to say, but all I'm telling you is true. And all I've done for you. All your life I tried and tried just to find a place inside you. Laugh at me and turn me away. Say anything you want to say. All I'm telling you is true. And all I've done for you. What will you do?
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Bow your heads with me, will you, this morning? That's the question, isn't it? What will you do? What will you do with all this? You may be in the service without a personal relationship with Jesus. You know in your heart you're not ready to meet him, but you know today you can be. That you feel is the Holy Spirit drawing you to Christ. And I pray that God will open the eyes of your understanding to get a glimpse of just a little bit of the majesty and the glory of Jesus and the genius of the gospel. We've sinned. I don't have to tell you that. We know that. But the good news is God loves us, and that's why Jesus came, lived the sinless, righteous life. He lived the life we should have lived. He died the death we should have died so that we can live. And he comes to you the way he came to his first disciples and knocks on the door of your life and says, I want to come in. I want to be your Lord. I want you to follow me. That's what a Christian is. It's just a follower of Jesus. And he comes to you today and says, will you follow me? He did it for you. He died for you. He shed his blood to make you clean. If that's you today, I'm going to ask you simply to lift your hand, and as you raise it, look me in the eye, and by that act, just say, Pastor, pray for me. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call you out, but I want you to do something, just indicate, I want to commit my life to Jesus today. Is there anybody? You just lift your hand high. Look my way till we've seen each other. Anybody? God bless you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Somebody else. Say, that's me. That's me. That's me. Anybody else? One other question, one of the points was that Jesus is with us when we're involved in ministry, and maybe you're not a part of a ministry team, but I think it's important when we hear and we're pricked to kind of at least begin a process by starting. And if that's you and you say, Pastor, I want to join a ministry team. That doesn't mean tomorrow you'll be doing something, but we can connect with you and find where you fit. And if that's you, would you just lift a hand just to the Lord this morning and say, yeah, that's me. That's me. Anybody? Okay, stand with me, will you, this morning? And could we say our family prayer? All of us pray this aloud after me. You that lifted your hand, you pray it too aloud. God's going to hear you and hear us. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I've fallen short of your standard. I'm sorry for my sin. I ask Jesus to forgive me. I believe Jesus is God. I believe he came to earth as a man. I believe he lived a sinless life. I believe he died on the cross for me. I believe his blood makes me clean. And I believe God rose him from, that he rose from the dead. And I believe he's alive forevermore. Come into my life, Lord Jesus. Forgive my sins. And be my Lord. And I put my faith today in your resurrection. I thank you for hearing me. I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, the word says that when this happens, that you call the angels around and say, rejoice with me. And Lord, we rejoice with you today. Thank you for a new name written in your book of life. And I pray for my sister today that the life that's been implanted within her will grow and develop and mature and bear fruit, and that she will stand throughout forever and ever as an example of your grace and mercy and wisdom and love. And Lord, I thank you for what you're doing in our lives and in our church. And I pray, Lord, that you will be Lord and Master and King over everything. And we give you praise today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Happy Resurrection Day. May the grace of the Lord and the love of Jesus and the fellowship of the Spirit be with you. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Thank you.